Hello and welcome to another Travelogue episode on my C++ weekly channel here. If you're not interested in this thing, please feel free to skip it. In this episode, I'm going to pick up where I left off on the Folkestone Travelogue. After C++ on C, we pre-booked our tickets to go back to St. Pancras International, which is a direct train from Folkestone. In case I haven't mentioned this before, if you are not used to train travel, which means you're probably in North America, then you should be sure to keep your train ticket after going through the gate to get into the train station, because you'll probably need the same ticket to get back out the other gate on the other side. St. Pancras is right next to the very famous King's Cross Station if you want to check that out while you're in the area. We used bounce luggage storage again, just like we did in Vancouver, and dropped our bags near the station. So, surprise, it was raining in London. Who would have expected, particularly after all of the rainy weather that we had had in Folkestone just a couple of days ago. And everything was very crowded. We are here on a Saturday afternoon at this point. So my first tip here is make sure you pre-book the things you want to do in London to avoid lines, get cheaper prices, and guarantee your spot. We kind of wandered around looking for interesting things, got some hot coffee, and happened upon an open house for the architecture college. And this was actually really cool. I wandered around and looked at several of these models and interacted briefly with one of the students that was there, showing his parents some of his stuff. And I honestly kind of wish I had gotten a short interview with him. It would have been fun. The weather cleared up for a minute and we got to enjoy Queen Mary's Rose Garden inside of Regent's Park. This is free entrance and it really is a very neat area to see all these well-maintained flowers. We then wandered past the Sherlock Holmes Museum at 221B Baker Street, and it was rather crowded with a long line as well, so we opted to just explore the gift shop and took some selfies here. We walked back to our luggage storage, got our bags, and took the Elizabeth line again over to West London where our Airbnb was. From this point on, we used tap in, tap out for the trains with our cell phones. Not all stations have gates when you leave, so you have to remember to tap out with your phone in order to risk not getting a lot of extra charges. And the process is pretty simple. You literally just do like you would with Tap and Pay for Apple Pay or Google Pay or Garmin Pay or whatever. And you tap your device when you enter the train station and you tap your device again when you leave the train station. It was a bit of a hike to our Airbnb and we were exhausted at this point. So we took an Uber out to get groceries after checking in and then chilled the rest of the night. We did walk back from the grocery store. But this day was over 29,000 steps for me, which is, if you have any kind of step counter, that's a lot. On day two, we decided to head away from the city to avoid the crowds of people that were likely to be in downtown London on Sunday. So we headed to Windsor and Windsor Castle. We did the tap-in, tap-out thing and took the train from Elizabeth Hanwell to Southall, changed trains to a local one which stopped in Slough,
when I'm there, please do bathroom and take care. Well, on the stairs, please use the handrail and take care.
Then change lines to the GWR line to one that runs between Slough and Windsor. Windsor, the town, is everything that I hoped it would be. It is a complete tourist trap built into a medieval town dating from the 1100s. And this is great. Sometimes that's just what you want. You want all the ridiculous touristy shops that try to sell you, you know, suits of armor and stuff. We did pre-book for a timed entry to the Windsor grounds and saved money over using the box office, plus guaranteed our spot. We didn't know how busy things were going to be like they had been in London on Saturday afternoon. We saw the line for Queen Mary's Doll's House and just didn't think that sounded very interesting. Maybe decided we would come back to it later and instead went to the Royal Apartments, which had no line at the moment. The Royal Apartments were amazing and crazy to see that they have been in continuous use for so long in some form, with kings and queens quarters and all of the things, and I do recommend doing that, but it was definitely a mistake for us to skip the dollhouse because when we got out of the apartments and went back around, it was raining more and the line to the dollhouse was even longer. So we did not end up doing that. But the Queen Mary's Doll's House is just this ridiculously impressively detailed thing. I didn't get pictures, but I can show you the official webpage. We walked around the grounds for a little bit, but again, the weather wasn't great, so we didn't spend too much time outside. We did go into the gift shop and mail a postcard to Grandma, as we like to do while traveling. But unfortunately, this postcard never seems to have actually arrived back in the US, and we've never had this problem before. Ultimately, the day got rained out. We went in and out of some of the touristy shops, bought a couple of random things, but then ended up landing in a small pub to have a real ale, eat our packed lunches, and then head back to where our Airbnb was. As an aside, if you've never had a real ale and you do like beer, I do recommend getting one while you're in England. These things are a fairly uniquely British thing, and they are just simple casked ales that are cellar casked and hand pumped up for you when you order one by the bartender, and they're good. They're tasty, they're relatively low alcohol content, and just something to try and drink for the experience, if nothing else. We got the train back to Southall and decided to walk from there to Hanwell, where we were staying. We had to deal a little bit with some sprinkly rain and maybe a little bit not perfectly pleasant walking paths until we managed to actually make our way to this canal path and followed that back to where we were staying. This was just a highlight of the day in some ways because it was just the small picturesque British town kind of area that you might have in your head. Along the way, we did see a cat who may or may not have had a quest for us.
Do you have a quest for us?
We got back relatively early today, but were tired from the cold, rainy weather, and it was fine to just spend the afternoon warming up. And that's another travel tip. Don't feel like you have to pack every single moment of the day with activity. It's not worth it. Day 3, now in London, or day 2.5, This was our final day, and it was a Monday. This was our most eventful and interesting day in London, so there's a lot to talk about here. We took the train again, Elizabeth Line, to Tottenham Court Road, and strolled over to St. Bartholomew the Great's Church. This is also known as Great St. Bart's. This church dates back 900 years and is one of the most interesting British churches I have been in. At this particular time, there was an art exhibit going. While we were out, we learned about the City of London Community Toilet Scheme as well, and I'll share a link to that. This is a map of free local public toilets that are available. From St. Bart's, we walked to the Guildhall Art Museum, which is completely free. This is absolutely a hidden gem in the city. Lots of art, plus they discovered a Roman amphitheater in the basement while digging out the foundations in the 80s. This is really interesting because they had known for a long time that there had to be a Roman amphitheater somewhere in London, but no one was quite sure where it was, and then they happened upon it in 1988. Definitely recommend swinging by here, spending a few minutes walking around the galleries. From the Guildhall, we meandered through Leadenhall Market along with many other tourists. This is the second time we've been to the Leadenhall area, but I didn't get any video of that from the previous trips.
It's very small.
We got a drink at Black Sheep Coffee, well, again, 8 packed lunches. From Black Sheep, we made our way over to the Tower of London. Now, I would say that the Tower of London is a must-see for your trip to London. It offers more things to do per unit of currency than anything else that we did in the Greater London area. We could have easily spent an entire day here. I still recommend going on a less busy day and getting there early. Go straight for the crown jewels while the line is shorter. You're not allowed to take pictures inside at the crown jewels, but it's still absolutely worth going in to see. It's a crazy amount of artifacts and history there. When you are done at the crown jewels, I then recommend going out and doing the rampart walk. We did these things in the wrong order, just so you know, but it's all worth it. Then head into the Tower Armory. Be sure to check out all of the other things. There's a tower where prisoners were kept. You've got to spend some time talking to the tower guards, also known as the yeoman warders. And this is where I will spend a brief moment talking about the ridiculously long names that these British things all officially have. For example, the Yeoman Warders, technically their full name is the Yeoman Warders of His Majesty's Royal Palace and Fortress, the Tower of London, and members of the Sovereign's Bodyguard of the Yeoman Guard Extraordinary. And while we're talking about Tower London, the Tower of London's official name is His Majesty's Royal Palace and Fortress of the Tower of London. And I think I have this right, the official name of Windsor Castle is Windsor Castle, including all the buildings within the walls. Okay, back to the Yeoman Warders. These are all retired British military who have had long and distinguished careers themselves. They all had to have been in at least 22 years. They had to have been warrant officers, and they were required to have gotten certain recognitions during their military career. They are great people to talk to. You absolutely need to spend some time talking to them and probably take a walking tour, which is free as well. And this is part of why you could really spend the entire day here on the tower grounds. There's also this thing called the Gunpowder Plot Experience, and that is an additional cost. We did not do that. It was sold out. I would also recommend looking at that. Tips and takeaways from this trip are, one, book in advance for activities you plan to do in London. Avoid the weekends and crowds if you can. I strongly recommend this. We weren't even there at a particularly busy time and it was ridiculously busy. And then also use tap in, tap out for trains and subway if you can. This is just a terribly convenient way of traveling. I hope you enjoyed this episode on things to do and see in 2.5 days in the Greater London area.